Thank you very much, everybody, and thank you for being here. The smoke and mirrors is one thing, but I think I would like to focus on the positive, not surprisingly. So first of all, I want to acknowledge that my colleague MP Murray Rankin is here, and he will take our message with him to Ottawa. Second, I want to explain what I'm wearing. I am oil and water. And notice how much oil there is. The water is all covered up. That's what would happen if there were a spill here on our coasts. That is not okay. The bitumen. I am bitumen and water. And that is not okay. But I think the message that we need to send as Victoria all the way to Ottawa, you know what? They watch the news. They read the newspapers. This panel isn't going to make recommendations, but we, standing here as a community, we are making recommendations. Yes. And this panel and the federal government will be looking at this pipeline expansion in the national interest. Community interests are one thing, and we know very strongly here in the capital region, we do not support this pipeline. We do not support expanded tankers. We have way too much to lose. There is zero benefit to our communities, and the risk is too high. That is very clear here in the capital region. But I think we have a stronger argument to make. I think we have a strong, powerful argument to make about this pipeline being turned down because it's not in the national interest. So I'm going to tell you what I think, and probably many of you agree, what I think is in the national interest. I think it is in the national interest that we become green energy leaders globally. That is in the national interest. It is in the national interest that we create more jobs with green energy than dirty energy. Job creation is in the national interest. Yeah. And finally, coming out of Paris, we have committed at the City of Victoria to the Paris climate targets. The CRD will jump on board soon. And if this country wants to send a message to the world, it is in the national interest to adopt the Paris climate targets and to meet them by not creating more pipelines, but creating more green energy, more green jobs, more energy alternatives. So we've made it very easy for Prime Minister Trudeau. We've just given him a whole list of reasons that turning down the pipeline is actually in the national interest. So finally and importantly, I want to say that I think, and I was here yesterday afternoon making a presentation on behalf of the City of Victoria, and the real leadership for this initiative and against the pipeline has been shown by our First Nations. And right now we're gathered on the Songhees and Esquimalt territories. They are an inspiration. These are their lands. We are stewards. And if nothing else, I hope that the Prime Minister takes seriously the words and wisdom of the elders, because if we're not guided by that, then what, I ask you, are we guided by? Thank you so much.
We had people left over from environmental NGO session earlier this afternoon, and we'll start off with Joe Foy of the Wilderness Committee, please.
Well, if I speak loudly today, it's not out of disrespect. It's only out of a desire for the people in the room and the people outside the room to be able to hear me. And that's the only reason I'm speaking loudly. I've traveled today from New Westminster. I would have normally made this submission near my home in Burnaby, where in earlier years there had been a Kinder Morgan pipeline burst that resulted in a fountain of petroleum and waterfall down towards into the ocean. But I was with my grandkids on a lake enjoying my summer holiday, and as I spoke outside, I think that's really, really important. Which brings me to my first point. We have the society that we have in Canada because we don't put up with stuff, because when we see stuff that's wrong, we speak up in a mostly respectful way, and it's unacceptable that we've got people outside of this room today that are not to get in here. That's wrong. If this were a municipal hearing, there would be, in many municipalities, a hearing tomorrow and a hearing to the next day and the next day. And so we ask ourselves, is this something that's important that we're talking about? And I say, and I don't say this lightly, I say of the 30-some-odd years of environmental activism, this is the most important issue that I've seen come down the pike, and I will explain why. I think fundamentally, it eats at the very core of what we are as this large, inclusive society. It eats at our very core of how we make decisions and how we are to live our lives. And let me explain. I spent quite a bit of time with my grandkids. As I said, I have some hopes and dreams and desires for them. And one of those hopes and dreams and desires is that someday, maybe tomorrow, maybe not for a while, we actually see consent and First Nations governance incorporated in the way our nation progresses. And on that day, our collective voices, we are a small nation in number, but our voices will be many times more powerful in the world that needs Canadian voices to speak with truth and power. I think this is the most important issue because, my gosh, I come from the Lower Mainland. The mayor of Vancouver, the mayor of Burnaby, all the mayors lining up, the mayor's here. There's MLAs in this room. There's our elected leaders that we value and trust and believe in have all stood up and said this damn pipeline has no place on this coast. Now, I'm speaking because I believe this goes absolutely insanely against all our efforts to do what we can do as Canadians to rein in climate change. And that means we should not be exporting bitumen around the world. We should not be exporting any carbon-based fuels. We should continue on our track where our kids are involved building more energy efficient homes. Some of my kids are in healthcare. Some of my kids are in producing food. It's all good. We're all doing our best. We're moving our society. And then this happens. Our elected leaders, the esteemed First Nations of our communities say, so many say no, and yet it goes forward. So what I ask today, what I think about now all the time, is how I felt. I'll give two examples. My wife is from another country. I was in that country. I was watching the news one day, and the top general came on to the news and said, I will no longer be taking direction from the president. Let me tell you what that feels like. That feels like you're alone. That feels like all your principles of democracy and human rights have just hit you in the face and you're by yourself on your couch. I felt like that when I picked up a newspaper and read that dam at Mount Polly had burst. That's the first feeling you have. You feel alone. And I want everyone in this room to think what it feels like in the first few seconds you hear one of them damn tankers burst on the rocks in the Salish Sea. I guarantee those first few seconds you will feel alone, and then the BS will start. So that cannot happen. Not only do we need to get this pipeline project stopped, we need to get the rest of those bitumen shipments out of Vancouver stopped. They got it done in a secret way. There was never any meetings when they got that done. And then we need to carry on. That's why this issue is the most important issue I've seen in my 30 years of working on these things that works. It erodes in what we hope to become, the place we hope to become. Thank you very much, panel, for listening.
The next two speakers are Susan Smitten and Charles Campbell.
Thank you. My name is Susan Smitten. I'm the executive director of RAVEN. RAVEN stands for... And I brought my groupies. RAVEN stands for Respecting Aboriginal Values and Environmental Needs. We're a nonprofit charitable organization under the Not-for-Profits Corporation Act based here in unceded Lekwungen territory. We've been running RAVEN now for 7 years. And our mandate, our mission, is to raise legal defense funds for First Nations, for Indigenous peoples who enforce their rights and titles to protect their traditional territories. Our vision is a country that honors the ancestral laws, rights, and stewardship values of Indigenous peoples and their equitable access to the justice system within a thriving natural environment. The fact that RAVEN exists at all suggests there's something wrong with how projects like Kinder Morgan are conceived and executed. We are still building infrastructure projects like pipelines and dams and tar sands industries, just name a few, based on a white, mostly male, colonial model, willfully ignoring First Nations and their rights and their stewardship concerns for land, water, and air. The future is not all skyscrapers and mega highways and technology. That's the stuff of movies. That's not what will support life on this planet. And as others have said in the other things, in the other meeting before this, now is the time to support renewable energy. Now is the time to listen to the lessons of our First Nations and understand what is really important. Our vision at RAVEN is to not to need to exist. I would like to not have a job. I'd actually like to retire. But projects like this and governments that endorse them keep giving us reasons to be here. So in the absence of meaningful policy change, you know, we all voted for Prime Minister Trudeau, hopeful that some of the policies of the Harper regime would be overturned and changed. Harper. It forces nations to try to get remedies through the courts. Following the Chilcotin title decision in 2014 and this year's Enbridge Court ruling, the courts are clearly a viable option for protecting First Nations rights and for protecting the environment. The challenge for the nations is the cost, which is why RAVEN exists. We raise the funds to help level the playing field and achieve some measure of access to justice. And just as a note, we raised and distributed $951,000 last year for legal actions, including the Treaty 8 Nation legal action to stop Site C, the Seven Nations. Thank you. The Seven Nations who took on Enbridge. We did that with Sierra Club BC. It was called Pull Together. We support the Honeywatin First Nation versus Taseko Mines, Lake Babine. It goes on and on. And the reason it goes on and on is because of issues like this. But we're the Band-Aid. RAVEN is a Band-Aid to a system that is fundamentally flawed. By the time we come along, things are already bleeding and broken from the First Nations perspective. So RAVEN is now supporting Tsleil-Waututh Nation. Yeah. That just happened this week, and we're supporting their legal efforts to stop Kinder Morgan. And noticeably, the nation is not participating in this traveling committee process. And I am not speaking on their behalf, but I will say that it's important to register that this process, as part of that top-down colonial system, and regardless of the intentions of the panel members here, and I know you're doing everything you believe in, this is another example of one-way dialogue. And it's explicitly not consultation, it's only information gathering. And on an impossible timeline that's not respectful of Aboriginal rights and interests. What is needed is a jointly developed process between First Nations and the federal government that recognizes and respects nation-to-nation relationships and governance rights. My father, bless his heart, he died 3 years ago. When he met my husband, who does Aboriginal constitutional law, and my father had a grade 10 education, but he was really thoughtful and respectful. He worked with wood, and he sat and he listened to my husband, and he said, "So let me get this right. What you really do is international law. That's where our government needs to get to." So the other key point that I want to make, because I'm out of time, is that the NEB process was deeply flawed, which is why Tsleil-Waututh Nation is not in it. And this panel does not have the mandate or the tools to rectify those deficiencies. The Trudeau administration, and this is what I hope you will take back to them, is they need to slow the process down. They need to work with First Nations to develop a mutually agreeable process and discuss the proposal. This will take time and will not be completed by the December 19th decision date. But because Tsleil-Waututh Nation does not have the confidence that there will be a change in the course of the expansion proposal review, they have elected to go to court as a more reliable way to protect their rights and interests. And in this era of truth and reconciliation, how is that acceptable? The final thing that this panel, I feel, needs to report back is this. The whole thing started on the wrong foot. It's a setup for failure. So without altering the fundamental approach to these projects, the outcome will also continue to be fundamentally flawed. So I will just conclude by saying that we will continue to do what we do at Raven as the thing that is needed until the fundamental nature of how we conceive and implement these projects changes. And I speak on behalf of all of Raven, hope that happens soon, because we would like to see our vision come to be and put ourselves out of business. Thank you.
Charles Campbell. After him will be Guy Johnston, if he's still here.
Hi. Sorry, I'm going to turn my back on the panel. My name is Charles Campbell. I've been a resident of Vancouver Island and Victoria since 2002. I'm an artist and the South Island provincial organizer for Dogwood Initiative. Firstly, I'd like to thank the amazing people in this room and all the energy you've brought to this campaign. I can't pretend to speak for everyone, but perhaps I could get a show of hands here to see who opposes Kinder Morgan's oil pipeline and tanker project. Please give yourself a round of applause. So this is an amazing moment. I was there when Dogwood held its first event for the No Tanker campaign. It was an information night held in a living room in a slightly run-down farmhouse in North Saanich about 10 years ago. Dogwood's four staff, most of us part-time, came armed with a PowerPoint full of facts and figures and a newly minted petition, ready to give our first ever presentation on tankers. Do you know how many people came out to that meeting? 8 people. 8 people. That was all we had at the beginning of the public facing No Tankers campaign. But the funny thing was that even at that moment, I never doubted that we would win. We were taking on the richest industry on the planet. Every article in the paper spoke about a pipeline to the West Coast as a done deal. Dogwood was so broke that at times our ED would forego his salary so we could make payroll. And our new petition opposing oil tankers now had all of 8 signatures. Adding our own, we got up to 12. Yes, we were going to win. The people in the room were not professional activists. Most had never been involved in a political campaign. But as they became informed of the issue, you could see a light going on. Not only was their passion for our coast ignited, but also their will to protect it. And that evening, a group of strangers became the beginning of a movement. My mind boggles now at the size of that movement, our movement. Literally hundreds of thousands of British Columbians have stood up to oppose oil tanker traffic on the coast. Grassroots, whoo! Grassroots groups have popped up from Kitimat to Chilliwack to stop tankers and pipelines. Resolutions have been passed by the Union of BC Municipalities, by Coastal First Nations, by Victoria, Vancouver, Sault, Oakbuie, Saanich, View Royal, to name but a few. People have spent thousands of hours preparing submissions for environmental reviews. We've written letters, held rallies, organized concerts, canvassed at farmers markets, met in church basements, quilts have been sewn, paintings painted, posters posted, songs sung, and court cases filed. Over and over again, we've delivered a clear, unequivocal no to this sunset industry that threatens our coast. Over and over again, we have said yes to a healthy, vibrant economy that relies on the sea to sustain us. Our question to our government and to this panel, when will you get it? We are not letting these tankers pass. Ever. Not now, not ever. You can ask the same question over and over again. The answer is still no. Last October, I thought we'd finally gotten through. A new government with a clear promise to redo the NEB's flawed and biased pipeline review came into power. And now, I'm not naive about politics. I know that campaign promises can and often are broken. But with the passion behind this issue, I didn't think Justin Trudeau would dare. I thought he was smarter than that. But perhaps he just wasn't paying attention. The groundswell of support and the huge increase in voter turnout that elected Trudeau didn't come out of nowhere. Yes, there was broad discontent with the Harper government, but in British Columbia, that discontent crystallized around one issue, oil tankers. Yes. Trudeau's promise for a North Coast oil tanker ban and a rigorous, fair review of Kinder Morgan set the stage for his victory in BC. We've yet to see either. So why did we demand a review? The NEB review limited public participation, rejected hundreds of interveners, and downgraded hundreds more. It refused to consider the cumulative impacts and the upstream and downstream effects on climate change. Cross-examination of Kinder Morgan's evidence was prohibited, and key peer-reviewed evidence demonstrating diluted bitumen sinks in water was deemed inadmissible on the grounds that it would be prejudicial against the proponents. In the words of Robin Allen, senior economist and former president and CEO of the Insurance Company of British Columbia, the review is not conducted on a level playing field, the panel is not an impartial referee, the game is rigged, its outcome predetermined by a captured regulator, the NEB's integrity has been compromised, its actions put the health and safety of the Canadian economy, society, and environment in harm's way. The new government promised to redo that compromised review. This panel is what we got instead. A panel scheduled hastily during the dog days of summer with inadequate notice and unrealistic deadlines. A panel mandated to find the gaps in the NEB process, but with no mandate to fix them. A panel with no ability to review or scrutinize scientific evidence, and one that once again does not allow for the cross-examination of Kinder Morgan's NEB filings. A panel led by a person with close personal and professional ties to Kinder Morgan's CEO Ian Anderson. A panel that does not even acknowledge, yet alone address, this serious conflict of interest. I said earlier that in the beginning, I never doubted that we would win this battle. Well, there was a time when I seriously thought that we would lose. And it was when this panel was appointed. My fear was that between the Trudeau honeymoon and the distractions of summer, not enough British Columbians would notice. That too many would make the mistake of a promise made for a promise delivered, and the lie of adequate consultation would become truth in people's minds. I'm happy to say I was wrong. Who in this audience recognizes this panel for the sham that it is? Please raise your hand.
Yes.
Raise your hand if you understand that building a new pipeline to expand the oil sands is completely incompatible with combating climate change.
Yes.
Raise your hand if you know that once bitumen spills, it sinks and can never be cleaned up.
Yes.
Raise your hand if you stand with the salmon, the orcas, and the diverse life that relies on our coast, including our own.
Yes.
And now please stand if you're willing to fight to stop this tanker project from ever getting through. Thinking back 10 years ago, to those 8 people in a Saanich farmhouse, I see the same passion in this room. And once again, I know we are going to win. Our numbers have grown, our voices louder, and our hearts are still true to protecting what we love. Thank you.
Is Guy Johnston from the Fishermen Union here from earlier today? I, Shazam Harrington, Matthew Helliwell. These are leftover people from an earlier. We don't have room, Matthew. Thank you.
Okay, y'all speak and then, okay. Is that?
There's a counter.
Okay. All right, thanks to the panel. Thanks everyone for being here. My name is Matt Helliwell. I am almost a lifelong Victoria resident and a recent graduate of University of Victoria. And like so many other students at university, my primary means of transportation was BC Transit. And there's a convention among BC Transit drivers that they'll pull up into the bus loop and they'll leave the bus open and they'll go and take their break until they need to leave again. And they'll leave the door open and they'll let students get on. And about 50% of students, when they get on the bus, they actually swipe their pass even though there's no driver. About 50% just walk right on. And I was among the ones that just walked right on. I didn't see the point of swiping a pass if there was no bus driver there. It wasn't until I heard from a friend that BC Transit actually uses the statistics of how many people are swiping that pass to see, so that student society and groups like it can use that as leverage and talk to BC Transit and say, there's so many people riding this bus, don't you think you ought to increase the number of routes? And so once I saw it through that kind of a lens, I started to swipe my pass every time, and I started to encourage other students who were coming with me to do the same. And the reason that I'm telling this story is because I feel, and it's been said before, that it can sometimes feel like a foregone conclusion, these pipelines and these mega projects. And I respect everybody who's spoken, but it seems like, how many times can we say no? How many times can we say the same thing before we're heard? And I'm just reminded of why I would swipe my pass every time that I walked on that bus, was so that they could see the sheer numbers. And even though it seems like I'm sometimes walking onto a bus with no driver, and I'm talking to a panel who won't make recommendations but will present the information that they've gathered to cabinet, who makes the decision, I'm just reminded of hearing those voices that are saying, why would you bother? And so when I saw that this was happening, and I saw when it was happening, I was discouraged, and I thought nobody was going to come out. And I'm just reminded again of those stories, and I just want to tell the panel and cabinet and whoever else is listening that makes the decisions that we're going to keep swiping our democratic pass. We're going to keep living here and taking the bus, if you will, and we're not going to stop. We're not going to stop making our voices heard, even though you might hear the same thing, 500 times in the course of this panel. I think it's important. It's what we have to say, and the answer is still no. So thank you.
The next three on my list, again, this is the end of the list from today's earlier session. Sandra Slobodian, Paul Petri, and Monica Petri. There's not enough capacity in this room. Somebody, can I speak? So somebody clicked and counted the number of people in this room. There's fire code rules that's beyond our control. Are you Sandra? Can yes. We let Sandra speak, please? Thank you. Sandra?
Can I just make a suggestion? If someone could call the names of those people, I'm sure people sitting by the door, if necessary, would stand outside till they finished talking, and then they could change voices.
We'll try and sort out some fair process with staff shortly, but Sandra is next on the list and is ready to speak.
Hello, my name is Sandra Slobodian. As we stand in this room right now, at the same time we are here, the Lakota, Sioux, and Chicana are standing up against a pipeline in North Dakota. Yeah. I'm not going to go on to list all the places in the world where this is happening, but I think you get the picture. I'm concerned for the relationships between the parties and the covenant with nature. The party of the first part is nature. The foundational principle of my faith is illustrated in this quote. Nature, in its essence, is the embodiment of my name, the maker, the creator. This illustrates that the natural world is a purposeful reflection from which, beyond sustenance and shelter, entertainment and livelihoods, we have a relationship. Party of the second part is the citizens. I was born and raised on the island. I've lived in Dawson Creek, Vancouver, and Kitimat. I'm of Métis ancestry from the Athabasca region and from the Red River. So I understand the importance of connection to land and the loss of agency over land. I'm a member of the Baha'i Faith. My family has worked in extractive industries for over 40 years. So I'm fully aware of the conflicting issues arising from extraction, either lumber or oil and gas, and we are complicit in the existence of these industries. But the people in this room are saying, we want to change. Party of the third part is the corporation. Well, that's Kinder Morgan. In this case, it was Enbridge. Now it's Kinder Morgan. We know that Warren Buffett and Morgan Stanley like this company, even though its long-term debt totals over $41 billion. This is the business we're trusting. Environmental disasters around the world occur in a furious attempt to keep us filled with our addiction to fossil fuels while assuring us it's the cost of doing business to have these disasters, that they will be responsible for making it right. 17 million liters in less than 4 years was spilled in Alberta alone. When bitumen sinks into the permafrost in northern Alberta, that is not making it right. The public's relationship with Kinder Morgan is characterized by distrust and resentment for the damage already done in Burnaby, 250,000 liters. In 1992, the precautionary principle was enshrined in the United Nations Rio Declaration, which establishes that the burden of proof that an action is not harmful falls on those taking the action. I believe that principle is not being recognized. The party of the fourth part is the government. A wedge of distrust has been driven between the people and government. Distrust threatens true peace, hope, and social order. I have witnessed a loss of evidence of confidence in both provincial and federal ability to defend the fundamental elements of society, the people, the water, and the land. To be sure, my concern is for nature, but I'm also concerned for the people and the relationships in this province, if this project is permitted. Earlier today, the word blockade was used. People have said that they will stand up before the destruction of trees and the implementation of a new doubled pipeline. I think that the government needs to listen to that. They wouldn't allow us to say it during the Enbridge hearing, but people have said it now. They are ready to put their bodies down. A vibrant population must have trust at the heart of their relationship with their elected office. The profit-driven corporate offices will do what they're designed to do. They will exploit for profit. However, we can only remain hopeful that their drive will be checked when we see evidence that their earth rights and individual rights are protected by a higher standard than that. The government shows little faith in Canadians by promoting and accelerating the extraction and export of raw bitumen. We are no less resilient, inventive, nor less adaptable than citizens of Germany. You have heard the tremor in our voices and you've seen tears spring to the eyes of adults as they speak. This is a committed and an informed public. A healthy economic, environmental, and social future depends on healthy relationships between the people and their government and the people and their earth. We need to rein in unbridled corporate ventures and honor our responsibility to the covenant we are party to with nature. And I believe we're up to this challenge. Do those who we elected believe the same?
Paul?
Yep.
My name is Paul Petrie. I'm from Pender Island. I'm here on behalf of the Friends of Brooks Point and the Pender Island Conservancy Association. I want to acknowledge my presence here on First Nations land, unceded, and I will keep my remarks brief in respect for other speakers. What I'd like to do, panel, is bring you to a specific critical point in the transit route of oil tankers from Burnaby to the open ocean, and that point is called Turn Point. It's where Boundary Pass meets Harrow Strait. It's recognized as the most hazardous point on the transit route of oil tankers out. And the question that Pender Islanders are asking and Gulf Islanders are asking and all of the people on Vancouver Island are asking is what kind of protections are there to prevent a shipping accident at that point? And I have to say, woefully few. There are some special navigation rules that apply to that area. They are being violated right now on the basis of the current oil tanker shipping. And I've documented that in our written submission to you that I handed in earlier. I won't belabor that, but we're watching violations of the current protections there. If a sevenfold increase in shipper tank, oil tanker traffic goes through there, we're going to have a higher risk. And I have to say this, that the current level of risk is unacceptable for existing oil tankers. The thought of increasing that risk sevenfold is unthinkable, and it's horrific. The Kinder Morgan put forward to the National Energy Board a worst-case scenario oil spill that they're prepared to clean up of 16,500 cubic meters of oil spilled at Turn Point if a tanker hits Arachne Reef, which is right across Turn Point. That's not the accident that's going to happen, panel. It's going to be a collision of two ships. The picture in our submission shows an oil tanker and another ship in very close proximity, violating the existing rules. The worst case scenario in the 2013 vessel traffic study found that the worst case spill from a single vessel would be the loss of 210,000 cubic meters of crude oil, 10 times more than what the National Energy Board considered in their approval of this recommendation. The National Energy Board process is flawed. Everyone in this room knows that. I hope that you take that message back to Minister Carr. I hope that you also tell Minister Carr that the current protections to prevent an oil spill need to be upgraded and improved, because right now we're facing an unacceptable risk. Thank you very much.
Monica Petrie from Pender Island, Sudeas in the Senchotin language. I'm co-chair of the Friends of Brooks Point, and I also belong to another organization on Pender Island, Pender Ocean Defenders. Our vision is to protect the Salish Sea, all who live in it and on it, from environmental harm, actions that would harm the environment. Our focus is on this endangered southern resident killer whales. Endangered and should be protected under the Species at Risk Act. The special operating area, Boundary Pass into Harrow Strait, which was just mentioned by Paul, is also critical habitat for the orcas. It's where they feed and play and travel. And we're very concerned for the future of the 8 surviving calves that have been born in the last 2 years into J-Clan. They are my neighbors, these orcas. I have been observing them in the wild for over 60 years. And I'm very concerned about the uncertainty of their future. And I hope that the panel will take to the cabinet, and particularly the Minister of Fisheries and Oceans, the obligation that they have to protect these animals. And the salmon, and the people who live around the shores, who depend on the ocean for a livelihood. Paul mentioned the spill response. Part of what Kinder Morgan said was that they would be capable of delivering 20,000 tons of capacity within 36 hours of notification. 36 hours is six high tides. Up to six high tides, that's going to spread whatever comes out of an inevitable spill all over our shores, plus what sinks to the bottom. We cannot recover from that. Not the people on the land, not the marine mammals in the sea, not the birds. So please take these concerns to the cabinet. Thank you.
Glenn Evans, Arlene Robinson, and Deb Monkman are the next three. Ten, 11, and 12.
Hi there. My name's Glenn Evans. I'm a resident of North Saanich, a private citizen. I don't represent any of the groups here. After listening to what has been said just now, I have come to the conclusion that my speech would be totally ineffective, and totally ineffective with members of the board who are not yet either children or are long past childhood and not yet in their dotage. And the reason is that it appears to me that only people in those ends of life, beginning and end, are capable of looking at the wider vision if they have got anywhere in society. It seems to me that people who get high up in society are totally unable to listen to anything that isn't following their own power or money, and that they tend to have a total absence of vision beyond that that counts to anything when the chips fall. My speech was going to be appealing to a sense of vision for members of the board to advise against Kinder Morgan's application. I now see at this last minute that that is pretty hopeless. And the thing that we have to depend upon, amongst others, is total resoluteness to pursue and harry the powers that be, whether it be the politicians or those under them, and make sure that we do not forget, as the politicians rely upon us time after time to do before the next election, and make sure that our passion counts more than the money. I am sorry not to deliver this, but I see it would not fizz on the members of the board and probably not on those above them. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Arlene Robinson, and I don't belong to any organization at this time. I'm here as an individual. However, I want to start by asking the board a question. Have any of you ever tried to clean up an oil spill? Have you ever been on a beach that's covered with oil? I have. In 1969, I belonged to an organization called SPEC, Society that promoting environmental conservation. We got 60,000 names signed trying to prevent, at that time, the Cherry Point in Washington were putting in a refinery. We went down there. They laughed not only at us, but at their own fisheries people who are saying it's not if, but when there's going to be a spill. They went ahead and put that up. In 1972, I was one of those cleaning up oil off Crescent Beach and White Rock Beach. If you've never done it, just think about, well, to me, it's like when my house was robbed and we came home and the door was slammed in. I felt totally hopeless and violated. It is such a terrible feeling. I think we may have cleaned up maybe 3 or 4%. Back then, of course, they only used straw and it was such a new thing. Here we are all these years still fighting this. We thought we won in 1972 when they put a moratorium, and thanks to David Anderson, he did a great job. Now, I can't remember the fellow's name, but when the Harper government was in, there was somebody in the environmental department who said, oh, we've never had an oil spill on the shores of British Columbia. What a lot of garbage. Not only was there that one in 72, there was the one in Burnaby. There was a bad one in Burnaby. But gee, they didn't know how much oil actually went into the inlet. But it was a terrible mess. Even in Cherry Point, the one that was at Crescent Beach, they told us there was only 2,000 gallons. No way. It not only ruined our beach, it ruined all the shellfish, the oysters that the government, the state of Washington, had just spent all that money refurbishing, and it was down the tube. I read that proposal. Modest environmental problems on the whales and so forth. Only 430 permanent jobs. What are they thinking of? What about all the jobs we're going to lose? This province depends on our tourism, our pristine environment. We have people from all over the world coming here. Why on earth would we want to risk that for 430 permanent jobs? It's totally ludicrous. 1988, there was another oil spill. I'm going to leave this because this is what it was to 2010 that was done the things that SPECS did on environmental problems. There was a collision, by the way, of an oil tanker in 1973. Did you know that? In English Bay and West Vancouver. Ask those people how it affected their fish and their there's no more oysters, there's no more crabs in those areas. You know, this is so no-brainer for me. And I'm going to leave so someone else can come in and hear everybody's views, okay?
Good afternoon, panel. My name is Deb Monkman, and I live in Mill Bay. And I'd like to talk to you about the health effects of oil spills and pipelines. I have a bachelor's degree in science and a master's in library science, and I've spent the past 25 years working for hospitals and healthcare professionals, including nurses like Janice Edmonds, who started North Shore NOPE. So together we reviewed 90 research articles and another 50 news reports on the health effects of oil spills. I'd like to talk about two things. First, I'd like to just talk about some of the anecdotal evidence, what people actually experienced in past spills, and then just reiterate what the gaps are in the knowledge base. So we know research is important. It's very important. We know that oil spills from the research affect physical health, mental health, and also our immune, our hormone, and our genetic systems. That's a known. But I think we just feel like numbers, like 58% of people experienced health problems after a spill, or 30% left their homes and relocated. So I'd like to instead share with you the words of people who have been through oil spills and what they experienced. William's symptoms began with coughing, then headaches and skin rashes, followed by vomiting and diarrhea. About 3 to 6 months later, he started bleeding from his ears and nose and suffering from a heavy cough. I got what turned out to be an autoimmune disease. Eventually, my bone marrow failed. I got aplastic anemia. I had 2 or 3 other complications. Really, it was like 16 years of illness for me. After a bone marrow transplant, 17 years after the spill, I'm feeling better and working. It can trigger illnesses in your that your body is carrying but hasn't expressed. It can weaken your body to the extent that other illnesses show up. And the average life expectancy of an Exxon Valdez cleanup worker is 51 years old. This one is from the only Dilbit spill on record in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where there is no long-term health follow-up. I see a worsening of symptoms, such as people with COPD. I see new skin issues, respiratory issues, headaches, memory loss, dizziness, and a multitude of complaints that are worsening. It's impossible to say that the spill causes these illnesses, especially since there's no long-term health study, but I'm skeptical. The deaths of 25 residents that I personally have known since the start of the spill leads me to question official assurances that there are no long-term health problems. And now for the gaps in the research, bearing in mind spills happen, we're talking a 7-fold increase in tanker traffic. Very few have been investigated, and there are very few long-term health studies. There are none for Dilbit. There are methodological issues with the research, though I have a 2016 summary of health effects of oil spills, which says that there are better methodologies. They've started to use control groups. They're doing baseline measurements like blood tests. And most important for us, there's no baseline screening or monitoring of our health in place. It all requires money and political will. I feel like we have enough environmental toxins to deal with in our world, and it almost seems like earthquake prep, where we think, yeah, it won't happen, it won't be so bad, we'll deal with it. But this one is 100% preventable. Will you ensure that this extensive research on health effects is thoroughly investigated, and that our personal family and community health is protected by not expanding the pipeline and shipping Dilbit through the waters where we live, and be the visionary leaders we so crave? Thank you.
There's a couple seats up here if anyone's still standing. The next 5 speakers are Catherine Cully, John Cully, Barbara Mitchell-Pollock, Eric Doherty, and Marie Rankin.
Hello, and thank you for having me here and allowing me to speak. My name is Catherine Cully, and I was born in Quebec and have lived in Ontario, Saskatchewan, and now British Columbia. I have a BSc degree in environmental biology from McGill University, and I currently live near Tidewater in Saanich. Today, I wore my West Coast Trail t-shirt to symbolize my recent four-day, three-night hike on the beautiful Juan de Fuca Trail, which would be in danger of being spoiled by an oil spill, among many other things. I was born in 1953, which is the same year as the Trans Mountain Pipeline was built, the original. And I know that my body is starting to fall apart, and the existing Trans Mountain pipes probably are too. To prepare to speak today, I read the recommendation document by the NEB. It is very long, very long. I would like to talk about two aspects of this document, bias and the so-called safety culture. First of all, number one, the bias. The NEB Trans Mountain recommendation document conveys to me a message of bias in favor of the project. Here is one example. The City of Vancouver's presentation in the original hearings about the Trans Mountain's environmental assessment report was saying lots of scientific reasons why it was inadequate, and they made very many good points. However, this document simply criticizes Vancouver because it wasn't prepared as professionally and correctly as the one that Trans Mountain, so they favored the Trans Mountain one. That's an example of bias, I think, that's quite blatant. They gave them a pass. On the subject of burdens, they found several to be significant, but offered no concern. Here's a quote. The board finds that there is a very low probability of a project spill that may result in a significant effect of high consequence. The board finds this level of risk to be acceptable. That's unquote now. Okay, another quote. The board finds that there is a very low probability of a marine spill from a project-related tanker that may result in a significant effect, high consequence. The board finds this level of risk to be acceptable. Burdens associated, burdens associated with the southern resident killer whales and Aboriginal culture use associated with southern resident killer whales are significant. The board recognizes that the increase in the project-related marine vessels would further contribute to cumulative effects that are already jeopardizing the recovery of the southern resident killer whale. And that's all they say. No comment, no concern, no remediation for that. And it's mostly related to the noise as well as the risk of spills and pollution. Marine greenhouse, quote, marine greenhouse gas emissions, significant. The board understands that emissions from the project-related marine vessels would be a small percentage relative to the Canadian greenhouse gas emissions, even though they say they are significant. I suggest that we address Canada's GHG emissions by not approving pipelines. My second point is about the development of a safety culture. There are several paragraphs or devoted to earnest words about the desirability of the corporate safety culture, but this is only words signifying nothing. We have an American company coming in here and buying our company and turning it into a shell and then using that to make profits to send to the U.S. And you think they're going to worry about our safety culture in Canada? And already, the other pipeline companies are similarly not concerned. Recently in the North Saskatchewan River, the pipeline was not shut down. Everybody's heard about that yes. Was not shut down for many hours. I heard 20 hours. In spite of anomalies in pressure that were detected by staff in Husky Oil. And the spill was ultimately reported by a third party. So that is the culture of safety in Canada. I think that's what we're looking at. And by the way, the document did tell us that the Trans Mountain is supposed to go across 1,163 water courses, and 907 of those are in BC, and through four major drainage basins and 21 different watersheds. I respectfully ask you to convey to the Cabinet the fact that the NEB document is just as flawed as the process that led to its creation. Yes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, committee and members of the public. My name is John Cully, and if you Google me and oil pipelines, you'll see a report I wrote quite some number of years ago on the impact of the installation of oil pipelines. So I actually have some background. I've actually been in oil spills and on land, though, not at sea. My brief today, however, relates to the financial risks. I thought I would deepen, go into a different area around the spills, which are inevitable to occur. The most relevant real-world experience is, as just was referred to, is the 2010 Kalamazoo Dilbert spill, which involved about 25,000 barrel spill into a very settled suburban area of Michigan near Battle Creek. Enbridge says it cost up to $765 million to clean it up by 2012. And more recent reports talk about a total cost of in excess of $1 billion US. The National Energy Board report for Trans Mountain recommends that Trans Mountain ULC, the applicant, have at least $1.1 billion in liquid assets available for cleanup of a spill. Frankly, a Dilbit spill deep in the BC backcountry would cost a lot more to clean up than one in suburban Michigan. So, having considered that, I was wondering about, so who is Trans Mountain ULC? Well, according to Bloomberg, it has neither an accessible list of directors, no management framework, no management structure, no financial statements. So presumably, it has neither assets nor liabilities. It is presumably, and I don't know this for sure, but I'm quite convinced that it is a shell designed to avoid U.S. corporate taxes. So, the National Energy Board document discusses at length Trans Mountain undertakings related to ensuring against the spill risks. It seems that an entity without a current operating assets or an apparent management framework should have some difficulty in accessing insurance policies against to establish a capacity to respond to a spill. If the decision is to approve this pipeline, it is wholly unacceptable for Canada not to insist on absolute financial guarantees from the applicant. If the applicant chooses to set off those risks against using insurance, that's fine, but they should have the assets at hand to deal with the problem. Without such assurances, you, the committee, the National Energy Board, and indeed the federal cabinet will surely turn out to be chumps to Kinder Morgan.
Barbara Mitchell Pollack.
Super, thank you. I brought my friend Daisy, and no reference that you people might be puppets as well. So Daisy is here to speak, but thank you for coming. But could you please talk to Justin Trudeau and the Honorable Catherine McKenna, because she's the Minister of Environment and Climate Change. And I think that's what we're all speaking about. And could you please ask them to put a credible environmental review in place and not on this putrid pipeline by Texas-based Kinder Morgan. Adios, but not happy trails. Because CETA, NAFTA, all those things, if they don't make enough money because oil is going down, they've got the right, which is bizarre, to ask for more money from our government. And that's money that could be going into healthcare, childcare, a living wage, medical, all the things that we need, and that should be our priorities. My optimistic hope, and one has to have hope, that's it, is that this repulsive pipeline is only a pipe dream, as it will increase, as we know, traffic tanker by 600%, increase oil. I could go on and on. Kinder Morgan doesn't have a good track record. 10 times oil spills that we know of. And when the oil spills happen, what they do is say, so this one was with the Kalahaka, they said 20 to 25 barrels. It was 40,000 barrels.
Liars!
That's a big difference. And basically, Daisy can understand the math. But once it's in the public domain, once it's in the media, people get those numbers and they don't see page 50 or the last page of what's going to happen. But, and I could go on more, but I won't because Daisy believes in being short. The most lethal and most dangerous spill is the one that could happen every day. So let me explain. When oil is burned, which it is intended to, CO2 pollution spills into the atmosphere, worsening climate crisis and acidifying oceans, carbon dioxide pollution that has already made the Salish Sea so acidic that oysters and other shellfish, which Daisy loves, cannot reproduce. All Canadians know that global warming is not a future problem. It is our present-day emergency. Every day we learn of mounting deaths, of destruction, heat waves, fires, tornadoes. Daisy's very good at tornadoes. Floods and fracking. Oh, sorry, my mistake. N is not for natural gas, really. It's frack gas. It should read LFG. So back to why this Kinder Morgan is a repulsive pipeline, should not exist, as it would spill tons of 13,700 tons of CO pollution into the atmosphere every hour. That's a lot. That is carbon dioxide spilled of 120 million tons every year, almost twice the GHG, that's greenhouse gas, by the way, pollution for the whole of BC. So building this pipeline would detonate irreparable harm to our environment and our communities. Thank you for your time. And please, can you talk to Catherine McKenna and Justin Trudeau? Because that's what needs to happen. Thank you.
My name is Eric Doherty, and I want to start by acknowledging that we are in the unceded territories of the Lwangan people, and that we are surrounded by the Salish Sea, which the Coast Salish people have stewarded with care for uncounted generations. And I also want to mention that I'm going to be making some fairly strong points about this process, but I don't feel that the two of you panelists here are primarily responsible for those weaknesses. The responsibility lies with Prime Minister Trudeau and his cabinet. I'm an independent planner and environmental consultant. My company name is EcoPath Planning. I'm a member of the Canadian Institute of Planners, and I'm a registered provincial professional planner in the province of BC. And I'm also on the board of the Victoria chapter of the Council of Canadians. And I'm going to skip over my educational credentials, which I sent to the National Energy Board. But I want to touch a little bit on the planning experience, the background that that I mentioned in my application to actually just to send a letter to them. I worked on the Victoria Transport Policy Institute manual, Transportation Cost and Benefit Analysis. And I've also done research on climate change emission valuation for the Victoria Transport Policy Institute. Previously worked for BC Hydro in the renewable energy sector. And my professional focus is on economically viable low-carbon transportation in both high and low income countries. And as you and everybody here knows, most of the tar sands oil goes to the transportation sector. So this has a very direct bearing upon whether or not this pipeline is economically viable. My research shows that grid-tied and battery electric transportation systems powered by renewable energy for both passengers and freight are ready to be deployed on large scale economically around the world, not just in the wealthy countries. For oil in the transportation sector can be rapidly and economically reduced all around the planet. In February 2014, I applied to present on these issues to the NEB, and they wouldn't even let me send a letter in. And I'm participating in this deeply flawed hearing process because I think it's essential that professionals stand up for the public interest even when there's no real place for them to be heard. There's no legitimate way other than standing up for 5 minutes to try to explain these complex issues in an overcrowded room. And I also want to talk about the cost, the damage cost of carbon dioxide pollution, because we all know that, you know, the Salish Sea is already so acidic that shellfish workers are being thrown out of work. That's an economic cost. We see what's going on in Louisiana right now with the billions of dollars of damages and the deaths from the flooding. And given those situations and looking at the science and the economics, I side with those experts who put the damage cost of carbon dioxide at over $500 a ton. So, the Kinder Morgan project, according to some academic experts who published a letter, would contribute 120 million tons of carbon a year. So that works out to be 1,140 tons in the 5 minutes that each of us have to speak, or about $500,000. in the 5 minutes that each of us is up here speaking. I don't think this is an economically viable project. And I have a few questions for you on the panel. Is destroying everything that humanity values economically viable? Is risking human extinction in the public interest? And where are the technical workshops on things like the damage cost of carbon, on the alternatives to burning fossil fuels for transportation? Are there going to be any technical workshops? Thank you very much.
Thanks. My name is Murray Rankin, and I'm the Member of Parliament for Victoria.
Thank you for this.
Panel, I understand I've only got between 3 and 5 minutes, and politicians can't even get wound up, so I've got some written materials to hand up to you.
Well, you got your
Thank
microphone
you.
Adjusted. Nobody else did.
So, I just want to be real clear in the interest of time. I represent this community, and I can assure you, panel, that this community is resolutely opposed to this project. Three reasons are given to me every day by my constituents, but there's many more. The first is a sevenfold increase of tanker traffic on our coast. 34 additional tankers each month off the coast of Victoria is one. The second is the impact of billions of barrels of diluted bitumen. And thirdly, the acknowledged impact, the impact that the NEB panel itself acknowledged on the southern resident orca whale population. Those are just three reasons I hear every day about why this project has to be resisted. There's a lot of uncertainties, what does diluted bitumen do in the environment, whatever, but there's one thing that is certain, and that is the devastation that a spill would cause. You've heard that over and over again. Quite simply, panel, it is lunacy to even contemplate playing Russian roulette with our precious coastline. It's ultimately the cabinet decides they have to make the benefit cost, the benefit risk analysis, and it's my position that any sensible risk benefit analysis just can't let that happen. I know you've heard countless people express concerns over the prior NEB review process, not hearing qualified interveners, failing to allow oral cross-examination, not adequately considering the marine implications of this project, not adequately demonstrating respect for the First Nations rights and title, or reconciling their legitimate interests. And you know what? You just can't remedy those breaches of fundamental justice with an add-on process like the one that you're part of. If key evidence was not vigorously challenged at the NEB hearing, how can we be confident that the panel's recommendations are sound? So our position remains that no pipeline approvals can be granted. There must be a thorough and transparent review process, along with a credible plan that will allow Canada to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions in compliance with our international obligations. Yesterday, you heard from a lot of local First Nations. You may not be aware that one part of my tiny riding, Victoria, is in fact an Indian reserve. The Songhees Nation Reserve on Chatham and Discovery Islands off the coast of Oak Bay. Yesterday I met with Chief Ron Sam and he confirmed to me that his people are also firmly opposed to this project. So I'm here to say to you what Mayor Lisa Helps said to you, what Mayor Gregor Robertson said to you, what Mayor Derek Corrigan said to you, and that is this. The pipeline and the massive increase in tanker traffic are just too risky for our city, our region, and our country. Last fall at the Paris Climate Change Conference, the new Liberal government committed our country to a more ambitious program to reduce national and global emissions to a level that might limit the world's temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius. I ask you this, just how can this project be reconciled with the commitment we made to the world in Paris? I don't think it can. I'm running out of time. I provided more material for you, but on behalf of Victoria, I call on this panel to convey these views, the views of my constituency, to Ottawa. You can be sure that I'm going to do that as soon as Parliament resumes. We do not think the NEB review process was procedurally fair, so we're deeply suspicious of the approval by the panel that was appointed by Mr. Harper's government. It is frankly shocking to us that the Liberal government would simply make you an add-on to that deeply flawed process and expect us to accept the process. You cannot simply put a fresh coat of red paint on a dilapidated boat and say that it's seaworthy. That boat will still, it'll still sink. And this project should be sunk as well. Thank you.
The next few speakers, Sheila Malcomson, Maria Arlen Bore. Sorry, I'm having a hard time reading the lighting, writing, but Sheila.
Hi, I'm Sheila Malcomson. I'm Member of Parliament for Nanaimo Ladysmith. I'm honored to be on Coast Salish territory, unceded territory. I'm standing with my fellow MP, Alistair McGregor, representing Cowichan, Malahat, Langford. And I believe a former MP, Jim Manley, is in the house too. Yeah, right on, good for you, Jim. So I am honored to have worked in and for the Salish Sea for the last 20 years as a kayak guide exploring Vancouver Island's amazing coastlines, its wild, untamed places, its highly delicate pocket beaches, which we know would collect oil six tides up and down by the time the first response vessels show up. I was elected for 12 years to Islands Trust Council, a local government with a conservation mandate, six of those years as Islands Trust Council chair, and was honored to stand up with many Gulf Islanders for strong oil spill response. We rang the alarm on Kinder Morgan when everybody else was focused on Enbridge, and we were able to go to Norway, learn from our American partners about how much better our neighbors and other countries in the world are at oil spill prevention. Canada's got a lot of work to do, and I was honored to be elected to learn that. And now I'm Member of Parliament in a riding that is making the transition from resource extraction into value-added, high-value, long-term, sustainable, good, green jobs. And there's a lot of young people, academics, Indigenous leaders, real innovators and entrepreneurs in my region that are working hard for that kind of sustainable, good job future. And this project represents all downside for that vision. There's no upside for us in Nanaimo Ladysmith. And I'm so encouraged to see that our only stop for this panel on Vancouver Island is in Victoria, and to see all these people standing together in solidarity gives me hope. And We have a federal government in place now that made some very strong and very hopeful commitments. It, number one, promised that it was going to redo the National Energy Board process on Kinder Morgan, and this is a total failure of that promise. No, with respect to the panel members, you got put into this job, but it's not what Trudeau promised us. It's not what this country needs to make a decision of such enormity for our coast. The fact that there is no transcription, that there is no translation, I don't think, until yesterday. The fact that there's all these people standing out in that hall who cannot hear what's being said, it's badly... And we still have had nothing to remediate the failures of the National Energy Board process, no cross-examination, no conversation about climate change. And you know, the fact that there was actually a public hearing with no hearing. We had conducted the whole exercise by email. It was a total failure of public process. So no wonder it's given us such a bad result. Okay, more lists of broken promises by the Trudeau government. We were supposed to have greenhouse gas emission reductions. In fact, this government is still representing the Harper Conservative greenhouse gas targets. A total failure. We have no stronger framework on oil spill prevention and response than we did under the Conservatives. We still have no confidence that bitumen can be recovered from the water. And in fact, and arguably, we're even in a worse position than we were before the election, because the Liberals chose to go ahead and, to their shame, close the Comox Coast Guard base. They implemented a Harper decision to weaken our environmental framework for our coast. And this summer, while we were all on holiday, they approved Corexit, very controversial oil spill dispersant. It's got occupational concerns that we know from the Gulf Coast spill. It's got the science is out on impacts to marine fisheries. And anyway, whoever wants to see oil dispersed, we want to keep it out of the water in the first place, and we want to remove it. And most concerning for the future of our country, First Nations commitments that were made around nation-to-nation relationship by Trudeau are not being upheld. If the Trudeau government's treatment of UNDRIP, of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission recommendations that it made solemn promises on, if the way that it handled First Nations leadership around the Site C dam process is any indication, we are embarrassed. Many of us in this room were with First Nations leadership just a month and a half ago. It was just protesting the Site C dam. It was just weeks later that the government, federal government, the Trudeau government, rubber stamped the regulatory approvals. After just a couple of hours of meetings with bureaucrats, they considered that nation to nation consultation. They should be ashamed. And so we are standing up with you, shoulder to shoulder, demanding a government in Ottawa that stands up for the coast, that protects the coast, that implements the framework within which we can have strong economies, protected environment for future generations and for the pride of our country. Thank you.
Are you done?
I don't have a speaking spot, just wanted to make a very quick comment. Please tell Mr. Trudeau's government that Vancouver Island's federal representatives are watching it. And if they fail to live up to the mandate for meaningful action on climate change that Canadians gave them last October, we will be all over them. Thank you.
Marie Helene Bure.
Hello, is it possible to switch my place with someone who really has to go to take her boat? She's number 22, I'm number 10. So I would be 22 and she can come right up to the...
What's your name?
Your name is?
Mary Brer.
Mary Brer. Thank you.
My name is Mary Rare, and I'm from Pender Island, which is right on the tanker route. Perhaps my greatest credential in speaking here today is that I have lived on Pender Island for 35 years, raised my family here, and been able to make a living there all these years. My roots are strong in this land, and so I speak from the heart. Even though the process is flawed, and I present before a panel that includes folks with perceived conflicted interests, it is important to me that I speak. I was a commenter and put a lot of thought into my submission. I wonder, did you, no, it wouldn't be you, but the NEB, did they read that? Did anyone notice? Did anyone read my letter? So I wonder, which of my many points would you hear would make a difference to you? Or the NEB, because I know you're not the NEB. Is it my loss of livelihood should there be a tanker spill with a possible exodus of people because of the disaster? My work in schools, my husband's employment, our vegetable, fruit, and flower sales from our roadside stand, all potentially affected? Or would the effect on our larger island economy get your attention? The loss of tourism and spin-off effects from that? Would you like to hear how a loss in our property values will affect us and our children? Or the harm to our food supply, clams, oysters, crab, fish? How about the mental health effects of individuals as they watch the shorelines and waters become fouled with oil and the animals dead and dying on the very beaches where they have roamed happily with their families? Would you care to hear about our endangered population of orcas? How the infernal underwater noise of increased tanker traffic and spillage will affect them, not to mention a catastrophic major spill? What is your criterion for what is important in life? To you and those making the big, powerful decisions, most of whom cannot ever really know how it feels, because this is not your home. I leave you today with a story. I am a snorkeler, and I swim in these waters all year round. One of my favorite places to go is a place people actually come from all over the world to dive. It is right on the tanker route. Sometimes when I'm snorkeling and peering below the surface of the sea, watching the strange and wonderful crabs on rock walls and the seafloor, the nudibranchs and sea stars, multicolored chitons, the incredibly beautiful white plumosa anemones, and swimming amongst so many fish of all shapes and sizes. Sometimes I lose track of time and place, and I feel like I am just another one of those creatures, at one with the ocean waters and the life beneath the surface. So today, I speak for the sea life that cannot speak for itself. Don't do it. The risk to the sea creatures and interconnected humans is far too great. Bravo.
Jim Erklishan from SPEC. I don't know if I said that right. So, you can correct me. Ron Spector and Ann Hansen are after him.
Thank you for allowing me to address you. I'm a founder of the Green Party of BC and the Green Party of Canada, and a former SPEC former member of SPEC from way back, so I have a little experience in this. But I'd like to talk, I'm also an economist, I'd like to talk about the economics. There is a kind of myth that if the Albertans have an oil pipeline to our coast, they'll be able to sell on the open market for a better deal. Anybody who believes that, I'd like to sell them a bridge. They simply haven't been paying attention to what's been going on for the past 3 or 4 years. Oil was selling for, $120 a barrel, and then it dropped to $40 a barrel. I've been down there for the past 3 years, but if you go to a gas station here in town, you're still paying $200 a barrel to fill your gas tank. So our chances of having any influence on the price of oil are pretty nil. There's, of all the definitions of economics, all the way from Aristotle to John Kenneth Galbraith, I think my favorite one is still Ambrose Bierce's definition in the Devil's Dictionary, where he defined economics as the study of how one man justifies the taking of another man's resources. And I think this probably applies pretty well to what's happening here. The people that want this pipeline are in a declining industry. If it wasn't for government subsidies, we would the oil industry would have been dying faster than the coal industry is presently dying today. And if they would remove some of those subsidies in Ottawa, we would have a lot healthier and a lot more advanced environment. I'd like to quote Vandana Shiva in closing, who noted that the entire economic system is a wholly owned subsidiary of the environment. And we cannot have a healthy economy without a healthy environment. Thank you very much.
Better. Panel members and concerned citizens, before I begin, I want to acknowledge the collective wisdom of the generations that are present in this room. Take a look around and see who is here. With all due respect to my long-haired, tree-hugging brothers and sisters who are often on the front lines, this room today is full of the resonant voices of concerned elders, voices that have literally centuries of accumulated great wisdom and must be listened to. I had the great privilege this morning to awaken with a friend on Rum Island, which is part of Gulf Islands National Park Reserve, and to paddle partway to this meeting through unspoiled and incredibly beautiful Harrow Strait, and seeing Boundary Pass and Turn Point. A few weeks ago, I paddled out in total fog to Tofino from Flores Island way out in Clackwood Sound. I needed a compass to find my way. Since this project has not already been rejected, it is apparent that we are still living in the fog. Let me say to you, panel members, we present are your compass.
I have been thinking.
But what it is I might say to this panel, this being one of the few opportunities for citizens like myself to have their voice heard on this important issue. Should I speak about our carbon debt, our historic carbon debt as first world peoples, and tell the panel of my experience with an indigenous Maya peasant in Guatemala named Bartolo Perez, who lives in constant anxiety of getting a harvest from the corn he plants as a result of the already intensifying effects of climate change-induced drought, and that is already affecting countless third world peoples and our own people in this country? Should I tell the panel about the clarity of the water I kayaked through today from Rum to Sydney, the overwhelming beauty of the coast and its sacred quality? Where can one find a coast as clean and mostly unpolluted as ours? This is certainly no longer something we can just take for granted. Should I tell the panel that I have never been to Las Vegas, never believed much in gambling, and highly esteem both the teachings of my own culture as well as that of the First Nations with regard to the exercise of the precautionary principle? Let us not gamble the millions-year-old inheritance we have been given, the life of our beautiful coast, for short-term profit for a Texas-based oil company. Should I tell the panel about the noise that even one tanker makes out there, the thundering vibration one hears as you paddle out on Harrow or Juan de Fuca Strait, and how the already existing noise from shipping imperils our iconic orca, humpback, and gray whale populations? All those might be important things to share, but what I really want to say is that each one of us, be we concerned citizens or members of the panel, have a vital responsibility at this critical moment in the life of our planet. The panelists cannot say that they were just following the orders of their terms of reference or industry's short-sighted and greed-oriented approach to our living heritage. You must exercise the great responsibility that has been given you and advise the cabinet that Kinder Morgan's expansion is a bad idea, a destructive and dangerous undertaking, and that it is widely opposed by the majority, certainly of the BC public and most of Canada. To do otherwise would be to recklessly endanger the web of life and the well-being of all who depend on a future not compromised by runaway climate change or a BC coastline despoiled by even a moderate oil tanker spill. You panelists are not simple bystanders. Future generations will judge you for the actions and decisions you make as members of this important panel. Thank you.
My name is Ann Hansen. Public speaking is not my strong point. So I've painted this painting, and I'd like to offer the next 30 seconds of my speech for the panelists to observe this painting in silence and to consider all the comments that have been made this afternoon and previous to that. They can accept or reject that offer.